Blink TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Bahraini protesters demand the right to self-determination. Jordanians continue to rally for economic reforms. And bomb targeting government bus kills 20 in Pakistan. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
شهدت البحرين مسيرات حاشدة في مختلف المناطق تحت شعار جمعة حق.
Bahrain witnessed marches in different parts of the country under the banner Friday of the Right to Self-Determination. Participants demanded freedoms and the release of the opposition's detained leaders, most notably the president of the Bahrain Center for Human Rights, Nabil Rajab, who was arrested for the second consecutive time, and Abdul Hadi Al-Khawaja.
The Friday of the Right to Self-Determination is the slogan under which the residents of Bahrain took to the street. They held marches that also called for the release of detainees held in the regime's prisons, most notably the president of the Bahrain Center for Human Rights, Nabil Rajab, who was arrested by the regime for a second time, in addition to activist Abdul Hadi Al-Khawaja. The marches launched from the capital, Al-Manama, condemned the crackdown and arrest campaigns that are targeting both young and old, a policy the opposition views as retaliation that conveys the regime's failure in dealing with a popular revolution in the country. The rearrest of activist Nabil Rajab led local and international human rights organizations to condemn and denounce his arrest. The Al-Wifaq National Islamic Society viewed Al-Rajab's detention as an escalation of the security option that the regime has adopted since the beginning of the revolution last year. The society confirmed the demand for the release of Rajab and the opposition's detained leaders is no longer an issue that only concerns the people of Bahrain, but has become an international demand. The European Bahraini Organization for Human Rights demanded the immediate and unconditional release of Rajab, the dismissal of all charges against him, and an end to the targeting and harassment of Hussein Jawad, the chairman of the European Bahraini Organization for Human Rights. In addition, it called for an end to the targeting of activists demanding democracy and human rights defenders. In the same context, lawyer Shahzan Al-Khami said the regime in Bahrain continues to detain 11-year-old child Ali Hassan. Al-Khamis added that regime forces illegally extracted confessions from prisoner Hassan and demanded his immediate release.
أعرب مركز القاهرة لحقوق الإنسان عن قلقه لتزايد.
The Cairo Institute for Human Rights Studies expressed concern over the increase in the number of violations against human rights defenders and their organizations in Arab countries, and particularly in Bahrain and Saudi Arabia.
السنوي الرابع أكد المركز أن محاولات إجهاض الربيع العربي قد اقترنت بقمع واسع.
The Institute confirmed in its fourth yearly report that attempts to sabotage the Arab Spring were often accompanied by large-scale repression in Bahrain and Saudi Arabia. The report referred to the crackdowns human rights activists in Bahrain and Saudi Arabia are being subjected to, the use of force against peaceful protesters demanding freedom, and the release of detainees held in the regime's prisons.
Thousands protested in the Jordanian capital, Amman, to demand comprehensive reforms and reject the rising prices and taxes. This comes as Jordan has been witnessing peaceful demonstrations and marches since January 2011 to demand political and economic reforms and an end to corruption.
This is not the first time. For over a year and a half, protests have been held every Friday to demand political and economic reforms and anti-corruption efforts. This march was launched from in front of the Al-Husseini Mosque in the center of the capital, Amman. The Islamic movement, opposition parties and youth groups calling for what they describe as an end to the policy of starving the people participated in the march. The new element in this demonstration is that economic demands dominated over all other issues. This comes after the Jordanian government announced its intention to raise the price of electricity, fuel, and some goods, in addition to increasing taxes, in an attempt to reduce this year's budget deficit, which is estimated at $7
billion.
In February, Jordan's public debt reached $21 billion. It was $18 billion in 2010.
We are protesting the government's policy of increasing prices. The government has abandoned its duties, and its only option is to reach into the citizens' pockets to make up for what the corrupt stole.
التظاهرات التي امتدت من العاصمة عمان لتشمل مدينة إربد والكرك ومعان تزيد.
The protests that spread from Amman to the cities of Irbid, Al-Karak, and Man raises the pressure on Prime Minister Fayez Al-Tarawney's government, which is facing the challenge of enacting laws, including election laws, to hold parliamentary elections before the end of the year.
More demonstrations in Yemen. Thousands have hit the streets in the capital Sana'a and the southern city of Taiz after Friday prayers. The protesters want the government to cleanse itself of the relatives of deposed leader Ali Abdullah Saleh. They're also calling for the prosecution of Saleh and his aides. They accused them of killing nearly 2,000 demonstrators since last year. Saleh formally stepped down in February following months of anti-regime protests. He was replaced by his deputy in a single candidate election backed by the U.S. and Saudi Arabia. A bomb blast kills nearly 20 people and wounds 30 others on the outskirts of Pakistan's northwestern city of Peshawar. Police say the explosion went off near a bus carrying government employees in the Daudzai area. And no group has claimed responsibility for the attack. The Pakistani Taliban are blamed for hundreds of similar bombings across the country. The attack comes one day after a remote-controlled bomb killed at least 15 people in the southwestern city of Quetta. For the first time, U.S.-led foreign forces in Afghanistan have acknowledged killing civilians in the country earlier this week. The victims were killed after an airstrike targeted their home in the eastern Logar province on Wednesday. 18 civilians, including women and children, lost their lives in the early morning attack. The U.S.-led military alliance initially denied all reports of civilian casualties and claimed only militants had died in the strike. But now it has not only admitted to the civilian deaths, but also apologized to the families of the victims. Jailbreak. Meanwhile, in Afghanistan, dozens of inmates have escaped after Taliban militants attack a prison in the country's north. Using an explosive device, the militants blew a hole in the wall of the compound in Saripul. The explosion was followed by a gun battle with security forces. Four prisoners were killed and 28 injured. The small prison was holding 160 inmates at the time of the jailbreak. Taliban militants say some of those who escaped were military commanders and district governors.
The following program contains graphic scenes that some viewers may find disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised.
Forty-four people were killed today by the gunfire of Al-Assad's brigades as heavy shelling continues in several areas of Homs, especially in the neighborhood of Al-Khalidiyya. The local coordination committees indicated that clashes erupted between the Free Syrian Army and regime forces in Al-Abbasiyyin Square in Damascus. The Syrian National Council expressed fear that the shelling of Al-Khalidiyya is a prelude to a military operation targeting the remaining neighborhoods of the hard-hit city. The committees called for an immediate intervention by the United Nations and the Security Council. Meanwhile, most Syrian cities answered calls by the opposition to protest on the Friday of revolutionaries and merchants hand in hand until victory.
Come on.
Massive shelling, destruction, and dozens of casualties. This is the situation of cities affiliated with the opposition, as they are subjected to brutal shelling by the regime's army. Al-Khalidiyya in Homs is enduring the heaviest shelling by Syrian regime forces attempting to storm the neighborhood since UN observers arrived to Syria. According to the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, nearly 5 bombs are dropped on the neighborhood every minute, noting that the shelling stops for 15 minutes and resumes at the same pace. More than 150 soldiers have raided the city of Al-Miqlabiyya in the countryside of Damascus amid indiscriminate gunfire and arrest campaigns targeting the demonstrators. The same situation applies to Al-Qabun, which was raided by dozens of armed men affiliated with the regime. In Talbisa, Al-Assad's army violently shelled the city, which led to the destruction of several homes and some injuries. Meanwhile, fierce clashes erupted between the regime's forces and the Free Syrian Army in the countryside of Damascus and the town of Mahaba in Daraa. This comes after a roadside bomb hit a military vehicle in the town of Kafr Shams. In response to a call for holding demonstrations under the slogan Friday of Revolutionaries and Traitors, Hand in Hand Until Victory, supporters of the opposition took to the streets and chanted slogans in solidarity with the besieged cities being shelled. The Syrian Observatory for Human Rights said the demonstrations were held across various neighborhoods in the city and countryside of Aleppo, the city and countryside of Hama, Damascus, and Daraa. The demonstrators called for the resignation of Syrian President Bashar al-Assad. The observatory further said the demonstrations were held despite the heavy security presence and the fierce clashes raging across various regions. According to the spokesman for the Union of Aleppo Coordinators, thousands of demonstrators took to the streets across the city's neighborhoods, most notably in Salah al-Din, Bustan al-Kusr, and al-Sha'ar. The demonstrators chanted slogans denouncing UN Arab League Joint Envoy Kofi Annan's plan. The Assad brigades in Shabiha fired live ammunition at the demonstrators in several regions amid a heavy security presence and random arrests. Meanwhile, a team of UN observers was able to enter the village of Al-Kubayr, which witnessed a massacre that claimed dozens of lives on Wednesday. Under the framework of human rights violations committed by the Syrian regime, Reuters released a video showing several members of Al-Assad's brigade stomping on the bodies of victims killed by the gunfire of security forces.
Tahrir Square is witnessing a demonstration titled the Friday of Determination to demand the retrial of deposed President Mohammed Hosni Mubarak and his regime's figureheads. Protesters are also calling for the implementation of the disenfranchisement law that would prevent the last prime minister during Mubarak's era, Ahmed Shafiq, from running in the presidential runoff election.
Angry demonstrations have returned to the streets and squares of Egyptian governorates, starting with Alexandria, passing through Suez and other governorates, and reaching Tahrir Square. Following the verdict of Mubarak and some of his regime's figureheads, masses took to the squares and held spontaneous protests. They were not mobilized by any particular revolutionary or political force. The protests, in which thousands participated, viewed the verdict as a step towards reproducing the former regime. The demands varied throughout the demonstrations and included the implementation of the disenfranchisement law of candidate Ahmed Shafiq, preventing him from participating in the presidential runoff round.
After the field marshal ratified this law, Shafiq does not have the right to run in the presidential elections.
We will not leave the squares until all of the revolution's demands are met.
Some members of parliament joined the angry popular reactions to reject and criticize the verdict of Mubarak and his aides. This led to a crisis between the judiciary and parliament, as judges threatened to boycott the oversight process and the runoff round.
All options are available: striking, not monitoring the election, and making this case an international issue.
The Million Man March of Determination is the second in 3 days. Observers considered the march an attempt to pressure the country's leaders to halt the presidential runoff elections until the disenfranchisement law is implemented. These observers doubt that such an attempt will have an impact on the election date.
It's very difficult to postpone the presidential elections under the pretext of an increasing number of people on the Egyptian street.
The fate of the presidential runoff election is still dependent on the verdict of the Supreme Constitutional Court that will decide if the disenfranchisement law is unconstitutional on June 14th, and in turn decide if calm will be restored to the squares, or if things will be turned upside down. Mahmoud Hussein, Al Jazeera, Cairo.
Open with continued tension over the upcoming slated evacuation of the Alpana neighborhood of Beit El and what is suspected to be a linked attack of vandalism in the Jewish Arab village of Neve Shalom. Investigators say that they believe that the tires of 14 cars were slashed in what has become known as a price tag attack launched by suspected far right-wing activists in protest of government policy. The words revenge, death to Arabs, and regards from Alpana were also spray-painted on the vehicles and on the walls of the bilingual school in the mixed community, which is located near Latrun. Just 2 days ago, the Knesset rejected the settlement regulation bill that would have bypassed a Supreme Court ruling ordering the eviction of the Alpana neighborhood built on privately owned Palestinian land by July 1st. Police arrived on the scene early this morning in Neve Shalom, which means oasis of peace. And coexistence between Arabs and Jews has been a community goal for the past 33 years. In an effort to reach an agreement over the relocation of the disputed apartment buildings in Beit El's Alpana neighborhood, talks have been initiated between a group representing right-wing activists and representatives of the Attorney General and the Prime Minister. The Haaretz Hebrew newspaper is reporting that, according to the outlines of a potential agreement between the parties, the structures will not be demolished in exchange for agreement from the residents to leave peacefully. According to a source involved in the talks, the residents hope that a deal will be made with the Palestinian owner of the land in the future, thus enabling them to return to their homes. Attorney General Yehuda Weinstein and Cabinet Secretary Tzvi Hauser are representing the government in the negotiations, with the head of the Yeshes Settlers Council, Dani Dayan, and National Union member of Knesset Yaakov Katz. Since the Knesset rejection of the settlers' bill by the Knesset on Wednesday, numerous tents have been erected in the outpost by activists gathering for the evacuation. An estimated 100 other right-wing demonstrators protested at the nearby entrance of an army base in Beit El this afternoon in further protest of the pending evacuation. The IDF used riot control methods to disperse the protesters after a number attempted to force entry into the base. In other news, Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas says that he prefers to negotiate with Israel, but given the absence of talks, that his only other option is to seek United Nations recognition of Palestinian statehood. His comments came during a visit to Paris, where the PA leader signed an accord with France, which will see several million euros transferred to the Palestinian Authority. Abbas has demanded that Israel stop all settlement activity before he will return to the negotiating table. Although Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has repeatedly stated that while he is prepared to meet with Abbas, such a meeting can only be held without any preconditions.
The Israeli occupation forces released prisoner Tha'er Halakhla, who went on an open-ended hunger strike for 78 days in protest of his 2-year administrative detention.
After 78 days of an open-ended hunger strike and 2 years in administrative detention, during which he conquered the prison and overcame the jailer's cruelty, here he is, Tahir Halakhla, carried by his family members and fans who have long waited for this meeting. Halakhla is a native of Haras town, north of Hebron. He was released in compliance with the latest agreement between the prison administration and the leaders of the prisoners' movement.
ليس نزهة الإضراب هو معركة بين لحم A hunger strike is not a picnic. It is a battle with flesh and blood and empty stomachs. The jailers have all the tools of repression. I feel happy. I feel a sense of victory. I feel free. This is a war waged by the hunger-striking prisoners Bilal Diab, Akram Rakawi, Al-Sirsik, Omar Sabaghi, Hassan Sabaghi, and Omar Abu Shalal. This is a battle between right and wrong.
The occupation attempted to break up the jubilant celebration organized by the prisoner's family by postponing his release until nighttime. This did not prevent his fans and friends from waiting for him until late at night to embrace him and share his joy at being free.
I'm very happy, very happy. But I hope all the other prisoners will be released, all of them. We want all the prisoners free. I will be very, very happy when they're all released.
I would like to dedicate this joyous occasion to all the Palestinian people, including all the leaders and citizens, because the people and the leaders are all working together side by side to support our prisoners, be it in the West Bank or in Gaza or abroad.
Prisoner Halakhla received both a popular and an official welcome after residents of the province gathered to greet him, most notably Minister of Prisoners Affairs, Aissa Karaki, who congratulated him for the release on behalf of the president.
This is like a Palestinian wedding. There is great joy for the return of one of the knights of the prisoners' movement, Thayer Halakhla, who entered an outstanding and legendary hunger strike for 78 days, along with his comrades. With his will and determination, he finally broke the jailer's will.
For his part, Taher Halakhla confirmed the occupation's prison administration has reneged on its agreement regarding the prisoners, especially in light of its continuing harassment against them. After 78 days of an open-ended hunger strike, Taher's life has been rewritten. He has achieved victory for himself and the prisoners' movement. From the town of Haras, north of Hebron, Dial Junaidi, Palestine TV.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible by grants from the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Wincote Foundation, the Firedoll Foundation, and by support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online. Stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic. Channel of uncompromising stories. World news, documentaries, entertainment, and culture. Link TV, connecting you to the world. For more information, visit linktv.org.